thank you so much for having me over here. It's a huge honor for me to be here and present some of my work to you and some thoughts of mine. And so I'm listening to the previous speeches and also understanding, why this gathering is over here. So I'm not here to figure out how to get you more money over here. But the thing is that, so for me, I'm basically a musician and an environmentalist, two pillars that have pretty much dictated my whole life and all my life decisions. And so I'm going to talk about the environment in general, about my journey into music and being an environmentalist, so that hopefully, you know, this can inspire some of you to bring in sustainability practices into your own business and understand that, you know, that it's important to, of course, make your businesses in your life financially sustainable, but at the same time, it's important to have a narrative and to even ensure that your businesses and your lives itself is more sustainable to the environment, to the planet in general, because at the end of the day, all of us have one home and we have to protect that home. So, a little into my background and my journey. So, from a very young age, ever since I remember as a child, I've always considered myself to be a musician. So, while most of my friends and most of my classmates in school were very fascinated by, you know, their television sets, watching movies, watching cartoons, playing video games, I was very fascinated and obsessed with my music system. So I would constantly listen to music all day. My ears were more important than my eyes, basically. And I would, listen to music cassettes during those days, and I would try to decipher, you know, who are the musicians in every single song, what kind of musical instruments have been used, what kind of cultures these different instrumentalists come from, what are the musicians and the singers actually thinking when they're writing those songs or they're performing those musical instrumental pieces and things like that. So I would say that a lot of my education when it comes to culture, traditions, when it comes to environmentalism, all of that has come through music. And also, through music, I found a very deep connection with nature. Now for me, it's very difficult for me to explain, but music and nature has always been one and the same for me. It's been just one mishmash of things. And of course, during those days, I could not explain myself when I would tell people this. But now I can sort of quantify it as to why, you know, I feel that music and nature is one and the same, simply because at the end of the day, how did music start? Music started off as sounds from within nature. Sounds of the birds chirping, sounds of the animals, sounds of the river flowing, sounds of rain, sounds of the leaves rustling. And then after that, it became humans trying to imitate those sounds, then humans trying to pull out objects from within nature like bamboo sticks and boxes of seeds and buckets of water and things like that, and trying to make these sounds more pleasing for the human ear. And it's only for the last few hundred years that music has actually become academic, where we've got rules and regulations for music, like, you know, like notes and scales and rags and things like that. But yeah, so basically music started off from within nature, and that's why music and nature is one and the same. Now, as all of you know, it is in your 12th standard that all of us have to make a very strong decision as to what we want to do for the rest of our lives, correct? Yeah, in our 12th standard. And so basically, I had made a very, very strong decision, a very strong resolve that I wanted to be a musician for the rest of my life, and I wanted to do music, I wanted to do only music for the rest of my life, and I wanted to do music till the day I die. I wanted music to be my bread and butter, my profession, my hobby, my everything. And I went to my father, who is a third generation doctor, and more importantly, Indian parent. So I went to my father and I told him that, you know, Dad, I want to be a musician for the rest of my life, and, you know, I want to do music forever. I want music to be my profession, my hobby, my everything. And he looked at me and he was waiting for the punchline to come in, you know. And he thought I was making some kind of a joke. And after that, there was a huge amount of fights at home and you know, and threats to leave home and all that nonsense happened. And after all of that, just to create a compromise and to create the peace at home, I made a compromise with my father that I would finish off a degree in dental surgery. And once I finish off that degree in dental surgery, I'm free to do whatever I want for the rest of my life. So that's exactly what I did. I went to dental college for 5 years in the evenings. I would obviously be doing music professionally. So I'd already started my professional career in music by then. But I would go to college for 5 years. At the end of 5 years, I did not know anything about dentistry, but I got a degree in dental surgery. So, which is pretty much a testimony to the education system nowadays. So I pretty much gave the system and I got my degree. But nevertheless, I got a degree. I very ceremoniously went to my father. I gave him the degree. and I told him that this is for you, and you know, and I want to be a musician. Now that you laughed at that, I'm going to digress a little bit. Now, so basically, so I did not blame my father for you know, for wasting 5 years of my life doing a degree that I would never really use, because I understood much later on that, you know, that he was basing his decisions on fear. You know, fear that my son will starve to death, fear of my son will not be able to stand up in society, fear that, you know, he'll not be successful, or fear that, you know, he'll not get married into a good family or whatever. But the thing is that I was basing my decisions purely on passion and love, you know, that was what I was basing my decisions on. Now imagine if there was a situation where I based my decisions on fear, and after I got that degree, I decided that, you know, that I decided that, you know, maybe I won't be successful because it's not a traditional career path. So what if, you know, like, what if I'm not successful? So let me just start a clinic in dentistry. Let me have a day job, and, you know, in the evenings, let me do music. Imagine if that happened. So I would go to a clinic from 9 o'clock in the morning to 5 o'clock in the evening. I would be treating patients the whole day. And all that I would be thinking about while doing these procedures on my patient is that, you know, when can I go back home, and when can I, you know, work, when can I play on my guitar, or when can I play on my piano? And I would be a very frustrated dentist. In such a situation, would any of you like to come to me for a surgical procedure? I don't sing, by the way. And my hands would be occupied. Anyway, so that's it. So basically, that's the way it is. So, you know, all of us within our own entrepreneurial lives, you know, we have to do things that we are passionate about. And not just when it comes to education and career path, but in every small thing, we have to figure out that, you know, is this going to bring me happiness? Is this something that, you know, is truly going to bring me passion, and then go into that field? Anyway, enough of digressing. So after I became a full-time musician, because I was already a professional musician during my dentistry, after I became a full-time musician, I got into doing commercials for television and radio. So that was my first career path when it came to music. So in a span of about 12 or 13 years after that, I done more than 3,500 commercials for television and radio, for various brands, like, you know, whether it's Levi's or Lee or Pepsi or Coca-Cola or Maruti or what do you call that, or Toyota. So basically I was doing music for every brand and their competitor, and for all over the world, working extremely hard. Sometimes I was doing more than 2 to 3 commercials a single day. So I was working extremely hard, and I was doing all of this, and it was quite exciting work. Not bad work, it was quite exciting work. But then, after a certain point of time, I realized that, you know, these big brands have understood the power of music. They've understood the power of music to drive a message of sales for themselves, because they're always trying to sell something. And we all know that music is not only a powerful language for communicating a message, but for also retaining that message deep into the consciousness of a listener. Like, for example, the jingles and the songs that we've learned during our childhood are the songs that we remember forever. Am I right? So the morals that we learn through the songs are morals that stick with us. It's very sticky, and it sticks with us, those morals. So I realized that these big brands have understood the power of music so much so that they're ready to pay me a couple of $1,000 to create a piece of music for them. And they are ready to spend a couple of $1 million to actually air that music on television and radio. So they have understood how powerful this music is to actually drive a message of their sales. So I was very ashamed to feel that, you know, that I myself I'm not harnessing the power of music the way I should be, even though I'm a musician, but these big brands are doing that. So that is when, sort of like a shot into the head, I decided that I am going to stop all forms of commercial music, every single form of commercial music, and I'm only going to create music on social impact, and I'm going to create music in my own small way to make this world a better place, and stop every single other form of music. So after that, since then, every single piece of music that came off my head or came off my fingers or my studio has been only about positive social impact, and that's what started a new journey in my life. And in order to start that new journey, there's this particular flute player called Wouter Kellerman, he's on his screen, and a South African flute player. I was a huge fan of his music, he was a huge fan of my music. We both wanted to work with each other, but we were trying to figure out how do we work with each other, what kind of music do we collaborate on. So then we met each other in Los Angeles, and while we were discussing, we came across a huge coincidence that I had just finished making a piece of music on our father of the nation, that is Mahatma Gandhi, and he had just finished making a piece of music on his father of the nation, that is Nelson Mandela. And we also realized that there is a whole lot of cross-pollination over there, because as we all know, Mahatma Gandhi spent his formative years in South Africa, so he had a lot of South Africanness in him. And Nelson Mandela was heavily inspired by the non-violence movement by Mahatma Gandhi. He considered Mahatma Gandhi to be his guru. So he had a lot of Indianness in him. So we decided that, alright, you know, I'll send you my music, you add South Africanness to it, you send me your music, I'll add Indianness to it. And then we ended up traveling the world, collaborated with musicians everywhere, spent 2.5 years creating music, and we had an album ready called Winds of Samsara. Winds of Samsara, as was mentioned in my introduction, it went on to number one on the US Billboard charts. It was the highest selling instrumental album in the whole world. Unfortunately, it wasn't released in India because, as you know, in India, you need to be part of the movie industry to be played on radio and television. But nevertheless, it was also the number one played album on radio all over the world. And this culminated with us winning the Grammy Award in 2015, which is pretty much the holy grail of music awards. And this is some pictures. And then after that started the third aspect of my musical career. Now, after winning the Grammy Award, I was invited by our Prime Minister, that is Prime Minister Narendra Modi at that time, 2015 it was, for a private meeting at his office. And over there, so it was supposed to be a photo op where, you know, 5 minutes and let's take a picture with the trophy and, you know, congratulations, thank you very much, which also I would have been extremely grateful for. But it ended up being an hour-long discussion at his office where he was talking to me about my work in the environment, because by then I was doing a whole lot of work with the environment, with the United Nations, especially in terms with climate change. So he told me that since you are focused on the environment and sustainability, why don't you focus in music instead of doing a variety of social impact? Why don't you focus just on the environment and sustainability and areas surrounding that and stop everything else? And as a sort of like a dangling carrot in front of me, he told me that later that year he's going to be visiting the climate change conference in Paris, that is the COP21, which, you know, the big climate change conference deal, the one which became very famous recently because Trump pulled out of it. So anyway, so he told me that he's going to be over there, he's going to have the main stage for a while. So he said that if I make an album which has musicians from all over the world and which talks about climate change, which talks about species conservation, which talks about pollution and talks about these various issues plaguing our environment, he said that he will actually launch the album over there and he will make sure every single world leader, that is 193 presidents and prime ministers, he said that every single one of them, he will make sure that every single one of them gets a copy of the album. So I thought that, wow, that's encouragement enough and that's good career advice from our prime minister. So I took that very seriously and I made an album called Shanti Samsara, World Music for Environmental Consciousness, featuring 500 musicians from over 40 countries. As you can see over there, musicians from Turkey, from Azerbaijan, you can see Amitabh Bachchan over there, musicians from Peru, Nepal, Canada, the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra from London, musicians from China, Vietnam. So basically, whichever part of the world I could find a musician who felt strongly about the environment, I basically brought them on board. And this culminated with our Prime Minister and the then French President launching the album at the climate change conference, and true to his word, he made sure that every single world leader got a copy of the album. And then after that, I went on to performing the album in more than 25 countries now in the last 3 years. Different countries. This was in Bangalore. This was at the India Gate. This was, I think, in Spain. This is in Canada for the House of Commons. There's about 25,000 people over there. And so basically, this is at the Mysore Palace. So now what I'm going to do, this is at the headquarters of the United Nations in Geneva, this particular thing. So I think I'll show you a short video of this. And this is at the United Nations General Assembly in New York. We performed in 2016, 17 and 18 for the opening of the General Assembly, performing over there again in September this year. And this is for the army. This was just last month where we performed for 10,000 soldiers of the army with a message of the environment. So at Leh, at an elevation of 13,000 feet, we perform for our men in uniform. Anyway, so what I'm going to do is that I'm going to show you a short clip of a performance that we did at the United Nations headquarters in Geneva. So just to give you a background of this, now when it comes to air pollution, all of us know that air pollution is a massive, massive problem in our country especially, but it is a problem which is not limited to our country, it's a problem all over the world. And also air pollution becomes especially important because all the solutions to climate change are the same solutions that we have for air pollution. So it's pretty much the same solutions to both these problems. Now the thing is that the WHO, that is the World Health Organization, they felt that There's not too much of inroads into, you know, finding solutions to air pollution or getting action into air pollution, because it is portrayed as being an environmental problem, and people do not create fast action when it comes to environmental problems. So they basically try to create a narrative where it is a health problem, which is absolutely true, because air pollution causes lung cancer, it causes a huge amount of lung cancer. There are 7 million people die every single year because of breathing polluted air in this world. Out of them, 600,000 of them, that is 6 lakh, are children. So this is a huge and a very shocking statistic when it comes to air pollution. So they basically decided that let's make it a health problem and let the WHO, the World Health Organization, take leadership in this. So they had this conference known as the Breathe Life Conference to launch this particular thing. And I got a call from the WHO that we wanted to do a concert at our headquarters the night before all the world leaders who come to our headquarters give commitments. So we'll bring all these world leaders to your concert. You have to inspire the hell out of them so that the next day in the morning when they come for the conference, they will basically give commitments. Every single one of them will just give commitments, open their hearts and give commitments. So this is the concert. Can you get the lights?
And I urge you to do the same, to commit, to find ways you can contribute to improving the quality of the air we breathe.
This concert is for a really good purpose, to improve the quality of life on Earth.
Simplify the message through songs. It becomes easier for the youth to embrace it.
Tackling pollution is not the exclusive reserve of academics and experts. There is a place also for artists.
We are a climate, clean air, and we are here to breathe life.
We as humans, as we know, we only protect things that we love. We will all find it within ourselves to clean, to protect, and to conserve. We do not inherit this world from our ancestors, but we borrow it from our children.
It wasn't just music. It was emotion, it was art, it was image. It leaves me with goosebumps.
Nine out of 10 children on this planet do not breathe clean or safe air.
I would like to thank all musicians for their commitment to a healthier planet.
To be in this audience of public health professionals and world leaders and all of us dancing and singing together,
so brave. To make all these excellencies and all the people raise up and dance.
People was happy, people was with more freedom and expressive and more committed. I thought it was really fun and engaging and inspiring.
The health of the forest and wildlife is directly proportional to human health.
We got enjoyment, light, music, and a key message from Ricky.
Hope equals to breathe life.
Thank you so much. So, now as I mentioned about the album being launched at the Climate Change Conference. Now, when watching the Climate Change Conference, that is the COP21, what happens is that every single one of the world leaders, that is the 193 world leaders present, have to go up on stage and they have to make a short presentation as to what they're going to be doing about climate change or how climate change is affecting them. So basically, one particular world leader who absolutely caught my attention was President Anothe Tong of the island nation of Kiribati. Now, Kiribati is a country in the South Pacific. It's 21 inhabited islands and very, very low-lying, almost at sea level, atoll islands. Now, he went up on stage and he gave a very short presentation. All that President Anothe Tong said when he went up on stage was that all you 193 countries present over here, please pass a resolution that ensures that my people of Kiribati stay above the water. And that was a very powerful statement. Now, for those of you, I cannot assume that everybody knows exactly the semantics behind climate change and what it is. So I'm just going to give you a two-liner about it, just to refresh your memories. Now, basically, what happens is that because of anthropogenic effect, because of humans, what's happening is that there's a lot of pollution in our atmosphere. Like, you know, because of factories, because of vehicles, because of whatever burning and things like that. There's a lot of pollution in our atmosphere, so there's a lot of carbon. So long story short, what happens is that because of the excess of carbon in our atmosphere, the global temperatures rise because the sun gives us energy every single day. So when the sun's rays enters our planet's atmosphere, normally what happens is that we use whatever we need for life because the sun's rays are absolutely essential for life. But the excess of heat and the excess rays always bounce back and they go back into the rest of the universe. Now the thing is that when there's a lot of pollution, the sun's rays gets trapped in our atmosphere. So global temperatures rise because more carbon dioxide means more heat gets trapped in our atmosphere. Because of this, the polar ice caps are melting. Now when the polar ice caps melt, as we all know, the density of ice is more than that of water. So what happens is that when the polar ice caps melt, when the ice melts, the water level goes up. When the water level goes up, all the coastal areas, all the low-lying islands, they basically go underwater. So that is, in a very simplistic fashion, that is what climate changes. Of course, it goes more in-depth into it because ocean currents change. Because of that, the places which are hotter become more hot, the places which are cold become more cold. The disasters like hurricanes, as we have been seeing right now, hurricanes and cyclones have been becoming far more powerful than they ever were. So that is what climate change is all about. Now what happens is that this particular country of Kiribati, 21 inhabited islands, as I mentioned, low-lying atoll islands, and they are going to be the first country in the world to go completely underwater due to climate change. So in the next 30 years, the tallest point in any of the islands is going to be completely submerged underwater, which means that we're going to have to redo our maps and our globes, and we're going to have to paint the part where Kiribati is in blue, because they're going to disappear from the face of the earth, and this is irreversible right now. That is, the Intergovernmental Panel of the United Nations has said that they are definitely going underwater and they're finished. Now the thing is that I went to Kiribati because I wanted to see this for myself. I spent some time over there. Absolutely beautiful islands, beautiful country. This is their capital, Tarawa. Figure it out, this part looks more shallower than that part. So basically this entire area used to be their capital, but now it's just become a thin, long island. And if you can only imagine, a 4-foot tsunami would just wipe out their capital. That's the state they are in right now. This is basically another island which has already been evacuated. This is one which is on the verge of being evacuated, all the villages on this particular island. So the thing is that, I spent a lot of time over there with the people, I spent a lot of time with the president, fell in love with their culture, fell in love with their traditions, which is completely indigenous and is in isolation. And I realized that this is a country that lives within nature. This is a country that does not take more than they can give back from nature. They have zero industrialization, zero carbon emissions, zero pollution. But if countries like ours, like developing nations and developed nations, if we can build domes around our countries and keep our carbon emissions and keep our pollution within our own borders, then countries like Kiribati have nothing to worry about. But then the problem is that it's one atmosphere. And our carbon emissions and our pollution becomes their carbon emission and their pollution. Polar ice caps melt, ocean levels rise, and since they're low-lying islands, they are suffering the consequences of our actions. So basically what we do within our businesses, what we do within our roles, whatever we do within our homes, whatever we do as countries, are not only affecting us, but are affecting people on the other side of the world. And that is what we need to be absolutely cognizant of. That, you know, that what we are doing are affecting, I mean, first of all, what we need to be cognizant about is that climate change is not some vague phenomenon that may or may not happen in the future. Climate change is absolutely real. Climate change is human-made. I mean, it's made by us. Climate change has got victims right now, as we can see. And our actions sitting down over here are having disastrous consequences on people on the other side of the world. Now, I'm not going to play you the video, but there is a music video that I made with their president and with their people. If you can go on the internet on YouTube and check it out, it's called Samsara Song for Kiribati. Kiribati is spelled as K-I-R-I-B-A-T-I, because the T-I becomes an S in their language. So basically, it is Kiribati. So basically, Song for Kiribati, look for it and please watch that video, because you'll have an idea of the children over there, because those children who are there in that particular video will not be able to grow up in their own country. So anyway, moving on. I just skipped the video. So moving on. Now there's a Sanskrit phrase which literally means the world is one family. Can all of you all tell me what that is? One, two, three. Very good. So Vasudeva Kutumbakam is a Sanskrit phrase in India. It's steeped in our traditions, it's steeped in our spirituality, it's steeped in our philosophy. It's in fact the basis of our existence within India. It's called, that Sanskrit phrase Vasudeva Kutumbakam, which is pretty amazing. Now the thing is that, so basically when we talk about Vasudeva Kutumbakam, when we talk about coexistence, when we talk about living as one family, when we talk about living in peace and harmony, what comes to our mind when we think about that? The only thing that seems to come to our mind nowadays is basically living in peace and harmony with Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Christians, basically different parts of the human race. And that is simply because we as a species have forgotten that we are not the only species on this planet. You know, we are just one among millions and millions of species on this planet. In fact, true coexistence according to any ancient culture, not just our ancient culture, but any ancient culture anywhere in the world, has always meant living in absolute peace and absolute harmony with every single entity in this world, whether living or non-living. So they've gone one step further, where it's not just living entities, but also the elements of nature as described within our Vedas also and within our traditions. It's always been defined as living in absolute peace with even the five elements of nature. Now the thing is that we as Indians, we've lived in coexistence with our forests and our wildlife for the longest period of time. In a sense, that's why we still have urban forests, that's why we still have large mammals. We are in fact one of the very, very few countries in the whole world which have got large mammals. So we've lived in absolute coexistence for the longest period of time. But with growing human population, with growing human greed, with deforestation and all of that stuff, we've got a lot of problems. Now, emblematic of this reverence that we have for our forests and wildlife is one particular animal which can be used as the best example, and that is the elephant. How many of you love the elephant? Come on. Everybody. So basically, emblematic of our reverence is basically the elephant. We pray to the elephant, we love the elephant. Elephant is pretty much a symbol of India. But as I said, because of growing human population, because of growing human greed, because of fragmentation of the elephant habitat, because of deforestation, and many times the deforestation is because of industry, what happens is that we've got something known as human and elephant conflict in our country. Now, human and elephant conflict is pretty much a warlike situation between humans and elephants. And human and elephant conflict usually happens in the fringe areas of the forest, usually in areas where the forest lands have been encroached by villages or by settlements and whatnot. Now the thing is that, to tell you about how bad the human and elephant conflict is that poaching used to be a problem, but right now human and elephant conflict is the number one reason for elephant mortality in India, and it has overtaken poaching as being the number one reason for elephant mortality. Now when there is human and elephant conflict, when there is this warlike situation between humans and elephants, and when there is loss of life or loss of property, especially on the human side, unfortunately our politicians are elected by the humans and not the elephants, am I right? So the thing is that what happens is that the authorities, and especially our forest department, which I absolutely love our forest department, and they are in fact the best department in my opinion in India that we have, the forest department is forced to capture and to relocate these elephants. You know, because they are part of a conflict. So just capture and relocate these elephants. Now this seems like a very logical and a very humane solution, because obviously you're not shooting down the elephant, you know. You're just capturing and you're relocating the elephant. But this itself, this capturing and relocation process, is extremely excruciating, very mentally traumatic, not just for the elephants, of course it is for the elephants, but even more traumatic, even more mentally excruciating for the forest department itself. Which begs to ask us the question that why can't we, you know, just follow our old traditions of Vasudeva Kutumbakam? Why can't we live in coexistence? And why can't we support our forest department? And why do we have to force our forest department to do this kind of stuff? So basically, I'm going to show you a song right now. It's called Love Divine, which is a dedication to the elephant, and a thought that the pain and suffering that we inflict on nature is pain and suffering that will eventually be inflicted on ourselves. And this is not just some wishy-washy thought or some kind of a new age thought or some kind of a yogic thought or whatever. But the thing is that this is the absolute truth. Because sometimes the consequences of our actions are not faced by us. It may be faced by future generations. Like in the case of Kiribati, it might be faced by people on the other side of the world. But we have to start thinking as a species. You know, we have to start thinking as a human race. We have to start thinking like that. So basically the next song is called Love Divine. I'm going to play this for you. You get the lights.
Big list.
Huh? No, how many of you know what they are? Like in the sense that you know about the concept of the SDGs? Not the 17 SDGs. Yeah. So now what I wanted to encourage all of you to do is that, because obviously the question is what can we do? You know, like what can we do within our businesses? Now as was mentioned by Nanjinda that, you know, that the thought of being, or the thought of sustainability is always that for me to become sustainability is that I need to leave something behind. You know, I need to give up something. And that thought needs to completely be erased from our psyches, that needs to be completely erased from our complete narrative. The idea is that you can be sustainable, you can be environmentally responsible, and yet you can be very profitable. And that's the way it is in the West. For some reason, in India, we do not have this narrative. Whenever you think about being sustainable, whenever you think about being environmentally conscious, you're always put into that thing of being an NGO, or you've got a begging bowl in front of you, or something like that. That needs to absolutely change, because you can still make money by being a sustainable business. So what my suggestion is that there are two things that obviously are the overarching things. One is that create a business which is about sustainability, like about waste management or about you know, species conservation or whatever. Or the second thing is that whatever business that you're doing, which even could be perceived as environmentally non-sustainable, like for example building an airport, like the Bengaluru International Airport. You know, building an airport. Just having an airport is bad for the environment. That's the end of it, you know, because concrete, iron, and you know, and you've got all these planes emitting so much of carbon monoxide and things like that. But at the end of the day, you can still become zero. You can become carbon neutral. You can sequester your carbon. You can mitigate your effects of climate change. You can do proper waste management system, and that's what the Bengaluru International Airport is doing. And they are a fantastic example of having a business which is perceived as being extremely environmentally unconscious, but yet, converting all of that into becoming a very, very responsible business. So anyway, so that's one example, but there are multiple examples. Now the thing is that if you can go through the Sustainable Development Goals, and I would really urge you and request you to go through them. There are 17 goals which the United Nations has earmarked for achieving by 2030. So they're known as the SDGs, or they're known as the 2030 Sustainable Development Goals. There are 17 of them. For example, one of them is poverty. Another one is hunger, another one is life on land, another one is life underwater, then you've got climate action, you've got innovation, you've got education, you've got all these different goals, gender equality. So the best part about these goals is that they are not, they do not force people to follow these goals. Entrepreneurship is under innovation, yeah. So the thing is that, so basically everything is under these, like a whole wide range of stuff. Now they do not force anybody to take up these goals, but they ask people to take up these goals voluntarily. Like for example, I have got a business, and I just say that, okay, I take up goal number 5, which is gender equality. I'm going to have equal number of women and equal number of men in my office. So basically, and I take that logo from the United Nations, which I'm free to do, and I put that on my brochures and all this stuff, saying that I as a company support goal number 5. And you're fully allowed to use that logo if you are following that particular thing. You don't need to take anybody's permission. So that's the way it is. Or I say that, like, you know, I'm going to support 2 schools in the neighborhood, or I'm going to make some education material, so I support goal number four, which is basically education. Or, you know, like that, you know, there are a variety of things, or like, you know, that I'm going to stop using plastics completely. So basically that's responsible consumption, so that's goal number 8, right? So basically we do, so basically you can just read those goals, figure out what connects with you, and then do that, because these are very good principles to follow within your business and within your own life. Now, to conclude now this, I'm going to be concluding right now. So I would like to say that, you know, that when we talk about a country, when we talk about a land, what do we normally think of? We always think about the people in a land. Now, I created, being a musician, I created an instrumental version of our national anthem, the Indian national anthem, because I love the composition. And while creating the video of it, what normally happens in patriotic videos, in India or anywhere else in the world, it's usually actors, actresses, you know, directors, celebrities, politicians, leaders, that's who you see in the videos. But I wanted to showcase another narrative, and I wanted to showcase the true narrative of India. I wanted to showcase the true citizens of India. Now the true citizens of India are the forests and wildlife, because they have lived in our land long before any humans have ever set foot here, am I right? Yep. And they have defined the beauty of our country, they define our country itself, they define the beauty of our country, and they define the sustenance of our country, and our own sustenance and our own existence depends upon us protecting our forests and our wildlife. Am I correct? Yeah. So basically, let us use our traditions, let us use our culture, let us use our spirituality to protect, to conserve, and to sustain our beautiful country, because with 1.3 billion people in our country, if we protect our country, we are saving the world. Am I right?
Yes.
So if you please indulge me, I would like to show you that. So if you please indulge me, let us all rise for the true citizens of India. Let us all rise for the Indian national. We get the lights first. Thank you. That's it from me. Thank you so much. Sustainable Development Goals that I spoke about, written in a very, very simple language at Baba Black Sheep level, and very fun, positive, nothing speaking about what is wrong in our world, but talking about what hope we have and how bright and beautiful our future can be. Like, for example, one song is about no more hunger, another song is called about plastics, another song is about the underwater world, about the rhinoceros.
It's all in English.
Share. It's in multiple Indian languages and English. So the thing is that, so, like, one is about the trees. So what we've done is that, like, for example, these are the English versions. We've gone to textbook manufacturers like Macmillan and other publishers, and the ICSE and CBSE syllabus. We've put this into schools. So right now the English version is in more than 4.9 million textbooks this year in schools. So it's being taught in schools so that children learn through rhymes, as I mentioned, you know, the songs that you learn during a childhood or songs that you remember forever. So might as well teach something that, you know, that brings in a new generation of children who are more sustainably conscious and environmentally conscious. So we've got that. The Kannada versions are going to be out in 2021 in textbooks in Karnataka. So that's going to be in 3.5 million textbooks in Karnataka. Hindi versions also 2021. I think that's going to be more than 5 million textbooks in UP and in Delhi. So that's the idea. And so what they've done is that they've divided the 27 songs into class 1 to class 8, into general knowledge, history, and English textbooks. So they've divided it beautifully, and this is how it appears in the textbooks. Like the song about carbon footprint, there's a QR code, so you scan that and you get the song for free on your cell phone. And all these songs, for all of you, all these songs are completely in public domain. So there is no commercialization at all. Anybody who wants to use these songs can use it for whatever purposes you want without taking any permissions.
Where are they available?
They're available on myearthsongs.com. All the assets are available as a free download over there. The only thing we request you is that tell us if you're using it simply because we can amplify it on our social media. Otherwise, there's no permission required at all. So that's the idea. So that's what we're doing for sustainability. Thank you.
Like, can I have it?
Sure.
So I come from Pook.
You come from Pook, yeah.
See, we have...
I see that going around a little bit over here.
See, we worship nature.
Yes.
That's what we do.
Yeah.
So we have a problem with these elephants. Because you spoke about elephants, I just wanted to... my problem with elephants.
Yeah.
See, I come from a place where we dwell with all these wild animals.
Correct.
For years, for generations.
Yeah.
So the problem today is very, very, it has reached such a stage where we cannot survive in this particular area.
Correct.
Because the forest department asked us to survive with these elephants. Hmm. It's not possible.
Hmm.
So yesterday night also, I came from Coop this morning. Yesterday night also, it was hovering throughout my house. 4 to 5 elephants. What I need from you is transportation.
Yeah.
I don't want to kill them.
Yeah.
I need help from you that you can use your good offices so it can be translocated to a forest area.
No, but the thing is that, translocation itself is a complicated thing. But nevertheless, as I mentioned in the song that you saw, so I do not have an answer because I cannot even begin to imagine the problems that you're going through. So I cannot be patronizing and saying that, you should be coexisting with the elephants and all that stuff. Because that's a very simplistic answer. But at the same time, you know, there are lots of other solutions that are provided which are sometimes ridiculous, like, for example, like building a wall. Okay, now let's say, like, you know, you build a wall or a fence. Now, a wall was cutting edge, like, y'all are all entrepreneurs, so everything needs to be cutting edge, everything needs to be disruptive. Those are the kind of terms that y'all come up with. But is building a wall a disruptive way of stopping an elephant from coming to you? Because a wall was cutting edge during the Great Wall of China. You know, that time it is cutting edge technology. But now it's not cutting edge technology. You have to figure out how you can live in coexistence, but at the same time, you know, the elephant is happy and you're happy, you know. So that is what, that is why innovation is required, and that's why nobody seems to be innovating. You know, and so that is what we need to do, because everything is simplistic answers. That if an elephant is bothering you, pick up the elephant and take him somewhere else. Or if the elephant is bothering you, put an electric fence, you know. Or an elephant is bothering you, let's kill the elephant. You know, so these are not, these are very simplistic answers. We need to go in depth, we need to figure out, like, what is it that is making the elephant come and bother you? Is it because elephant corridors are blocked? Is it because there is a railway track going in somewhere where the elephant is unable to cross? Or is it because this is the ancestral land of the elephant like 60 years ago? So basically we need to figure out and we need to go in depth into it. And there are people who are doing it. In the Institute of Science, I've seen a few people who are innovating and they're trying to figure out, they're following elephants, they're trying to understand the elephant and all that stuff. Forest Department is going through a huge amount of strikes to understand this. But of course, for now, palliatively, there will be simplistic solutions, unfortunately.
We've been planning to do a hackathon to get entrepreneurs to work with forest-related challenges. I think there were about five of them. We've tried to talk to them. I think we've also reached out to NSRCL to collaborate in that initiative. So where primarily whatever you may be doing as an entrepreneur, working at various things, you may have an IoT solution and all that. Can we look at all those things working with forest related, basically the human-animal
conflict
and whole lot of those things. And also we also want to try to, you know, we've yet to talk to the forest department to collaborate on that. NSRCL is broadly interested. We've already planning to do that. In fact, it was Vineet's idea originally. So we're trying to put that together to get people to think about bringing your entrepreneurial solutions to forest associated problems and how we can.
And then talking about entrepreneurs, one last thing that I'd like to say is that, see, when it comes to our politicians, actually there are two aspects to this. One is that the biggest threat to our environment, the biggest threat to sustainability is the thought that somebody else will make a difference. That, in my opinion, that is the biggest threat, that somebody else will make a difference. Yeah. Either governments will make a difference, or NGOs will make a difference, or intergovernmental bodies will make a difference. So that is where entrepreneurs come into place, and that's why it's so lovely to speak to all of you over here. Because the thing is that when it comes to governments, governments have to make short-term solutions because they have to be re-elected every 4 to 5 years. And this is a problem everywhere in the world. That, you know, that they cannot make long-term decisions. Now this elephant problem, climate change, these require long-term solutions. Now to have long-term solutions, the government is never going to take huge plans to actually do this because they need results every 4 to 5 years to get re-elected. And they need to show results, and that's where all these short-term results come out, you know, of like, you know, recapturing and relocation and, you know, and building walls and things like that. So what we, where, so the actual true leaders on this planet are basically the entrepreneurs and the business leaders. Because, it's true. So the entrepreneurs and business leaders, because you are the guys who can actually make long-term solutions, you all can innovate, and you all can do things yourself, and you all can stop thinking about who else is going to make a difference, because you all can make a difference. And you don't need to base your businesses completely on this particular topic, but you can just make your businesses more responsible. That's all. Thank you.